الله كمثل آدم خلقه من تراب ثم قال له كن فيكون. That the similitude of Jesus before Allah, before God, is the same like that of Adam. He created him from dust. Then he said to him, kun fayakun, be, and it is. For then he was more than just a man. He was a great mighty prophet and a miracle worker that basically went and was sent to the children of Israel. So with these words, I'd like to end with the Quranic passage which says, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقُ وَزَعْتَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَوْكَ. And it basically means that when any form of truth comes in place of error or that which is incorrect, then all forms of error will be bound to perish. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
From both sides, we have heard the pastors talking about who is Jesus for 30 minutes. And we also welcomed our brother from South Africa, our brother Yusuf Ismail, for another 30 minutes. Now we are going for the rebuttal or summary. We are going to give each speaker 10 minutes to put everything right, to put his house in order. I don't want to waste any time. I like to call upon the Christian side. You have 10 minutes.
Yeah, I'm really happy with the way my friend, yeah, I was trying to respond to Christian points, but I could clearly see that there were lots of things that were clearly misunderstood, and others presented with a very serious bias. Let me start by correcting what he refers to as the corrective view of Jesus. And first of all, even from a mathematical point of view, some of those dates, he needs to reject them. He says that the Gospel of Matthew was written at least 70 years after the death of Jesus. Now, if Jesus died in, from historical accounts, Jesus died around 33 AD. Now, 70 years from that, plus the amount of Jesus, the time Jesus had been here on earth, that will make the author almost 100 years. Now surely, if somebody has already 100 years, how is he going to write an account such as this? Or take for instance John. He says, and I was writing, so I'm not misquoting him. He says that John was written 110 AD. Now, John says himself that the things he writes, those things he did not hear them from anyone else. Neither did he even borrow them from Mark. He witnessed them by himself. He said them in the book of 1 John, that he is writing things about the person he has seen, about the person he has touched, about the person he has even conversed with. Now, if he wrote in 110 AD, and this John was the disciple of Jesus, it means that John wrote this gospel account at an earliest, at least 80 years after Jesus had died. I mean, some of these things are ridiculous. I just can't understand how Muslims are believing such things. That somebody is over 100 years, that's the time he's remembering to write about Jesus. Why would it take John that long to write things that he felt so dear about? Things that were so close to him. So my friend, I really urge Muslims that even as you listen to these things, please also take time and cross-check the facts by yourself. Now these facts are available. You can go on the internet. You can buy your own Bible. There are books you can buy even from Christian bookshops. Cross-check these things so that you don't just depend on what you are told, but also cross-check some of these things. Secondly, my friend said that Jesus never claimed to be God. Now, I cannot understand again how simple things can be, this argument can be. For instance, in this country we have a president, His Excellency Mwai Kibaki. His residence just up here. Now, whenever he moves around, he doesn't have to announce that I am the president of this country. He can say that in different ways. He can say I am the head of this country. We will know that he really is the president. He could give a directive, an order, and he's carried out. Nobody opposes it. We know he's giving that order because he's the president of this country. So usually you don't have to announce that I am so-and-so before people can believe you are so-and-so. Let's ask the Bible and ask Jesus himself. Did you teach that you are God? Did your actions show that you are God? In the book of Mark chapter 2 verse 8, because of time I might not be able to read them on these passages, but I'll urge you to write them down, read them later. In the book of Mark chapter 2 verse 8, there is a story of Jesus healing a person who had been paralyzed. But when this person was brought before Jesus, instead of Jesus first of all healing the person, he began by telling him, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now by that statement alone, he was implying that he has the power to forgive the sins of people. Now I'm asking you, my friends, which human being, which prophet, among all the prophets that you believe in, had the power to forgive the sins of other people? Only God can forgive the sins of people. So when Jesus was saying, when Jesus told this man that your sins are forgiven, he was implying that indeed he is God and therefore has that power to forgive sins. Otherwise, that would have been the worst blasphemy that one could commit, taking the privilege of God. Two, he alluded to the fact that in John chapter 10 verse 30, Jesus said, "I and the Father are one." And he says that according to what that passage actually meant was that they are one in purpose with God. But he completely or deliberately mistook or chose not to read verse 32 and 33. Whereby the Jews, when Jesus said, "I and the Father are one," those who were listening at Jesus up stones and they wanted to stone Jesus. And Jesus asked them, "Why do you want to stone me?" And they told him, "We want to stone you because you are claiming to be God." As I say, a person does not have to explicitly say that I'm the president or I'm the minister, but his actions and utterances will show you what he is. So when Jesus, when the Bible said, when Jesus said, "I and the Father are one," it was not about unity or purpose. It was because he has the same qualities as God the Father. He also continues and says that if Jesus indeed is God, then his death on the cross will be meaningless. Because being God, there's no risk in him dying. He will know whether they put nails in my hands and in my feet or not. After 3 days, I'll rise from the dead. Now, because I do not have time, I would like to ask the Muslims assembled here to take time and read Philippians chapter 2 from verse 5 to 11, where the Bible tells us that we should have the same attitude like the one that Jesus had, that while he was fully God, he emptied himself, he reduced himself to the level of a human being, to a level of man. Now let me tell you, friends, both Muslims and Christians believe, right, and rightly so, that God can do anything. It's easier and only possible for a big man to come down, but almost impossible for a small man to go up. In other words, coming back to the illustration I've used about the president. The president can choose to come here and either sit in front here or even sit with the crowd there. It is his prerogative. But I cannot choose to go and sit in settles wherever I want. I can only go there by invitation. Jesus being God, if he had come in all his glory as God, no human being can stand. So therefore, for him to reduce himself to a level of human being, to identify with us, is nothing to God. God can do all things, as we just agreed. So Jesus willingly chose to reduce himself to the level of human being, to identify with us. Therefore, his death on the cross was not just a walk in the park. He reduced to us, came to a level to identify with us. Finally, my friend also alluded to the teaching that the true gospels as they were written were not true. And he says this, that is, there is no perfect man, that Jesus, there is no perfect man, and therefore a repentant sinner is just as perfect as what a sinless person. Now let me ask you, the point that I made was not that Jesus was a repentant sinner. The point I made was this, that all human beings, of all human beings, or anybody who has graced this earth, And that's the point I wanted my friend to respond to. To tell me one prophet, one human being who led a sinless life. That qualification is a qualification to serve only to Jesus. But that's not the only reason why we say Jesus is God. I gave several reasons. I said Jesus is God because he gives eternal life. My friend did not dispute that, gladly so. I said Jesus is God because his action showed so. I said Jesus is God, is the Son of God, because even Jesus himself, he was asked this question by the chief priest in Matthew chapter 26, verse 62 to 65. He was asked, are you the Christ, the Son of God? And Jesus himself accepted and said yes. And you know, at that point, tomorrow we'll be discussing about the death of Jesus. At that point, it was a matter of life and death. If Jesus had said no, he would have been spared the cross. But it's because of this that he came for the cross. Indeed, just in conclusion, in the book of Matthew chapter 16, verse 13, where my friend alluded to, and Jesus had asked the people, who do people say the Son of Man is? And some say, they keep conflicting reasons, but at least they all believe that he was a prophet. When you read in verse 20 to 22, Jesus told his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and face the evil people, wicked people, and will be put on the cross, and on the third day, rise again. Now, the facing of the people on the cross, or of his crucifixion on the cross, was not a walk in the park. Jesus went through all the pain that all of us go through. Jesus' mission was unlimited. My friend said that Jesus was only sent to the children of Israel. Let me conclude by reading a passage in the Bible, and I will not add one word, just to put to rest this myth that Jesus was only sent to the children of Israel. And I'm reading from a scripture written by somebody that my colleague accepts that at least he was a disciple of Jesus. In John, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, the Bible says this. And let me start from verse 1. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. This verse 2, he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Now this person writing is a Jew. He says Jesus is the atoning sacrifice for our sins. And he continues and says, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. I think it's no wonder that even Muslims today living in Kenya must believe in Jesus. Just as my friend said that no Muslim can be Muslim without believing in Jesus. Why would they believe in Jesus if he was a restricted to the nation of Israel?
So hallelujah. Okay, that was the pastor speaking on his 10 minutes of summary. Mr. Pastor, you're going to...
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you, Pastor, for that engaging discussion and that engaging rebuttal. I just want to mention two things here. When you say that the conventional view that the New Testament or the Gospels were written in the time of Jesus, that is not correct. The dates I gave you were dates that are acceptable as authentic in the vast majority of biblical schools in the world today. Two particular writers come to mind. One is an individual called Raymond Brown, a leading scholar of biblical studies. The other is an individual called Bart Ehrman. Most of these particular writers or authors understand and accept that the Gospels that we have them today were not written during the lifetime of Jesus. When I said that Matthew was written in the year 70 AD, what I was mentioning was it 70 years after the birth or arrival of Jesus, not after his alleged death. So in that particular context, the dates that I gave you were accurate. But I'll give you one example. J.B. Phillips is a prebendary of the Chichester Cathedral, a paid servant of the Anglican Church. He wrote a book called The Gospels Translated into Modern English. In his discussion on the Gospel of Matthew, he says, early tradition ascribed this gospel to the Apostle Matthew, but scholars nowadays almost all reject this view. The author, whom we can conveniently called Matthew as plainly drawn from the mysterious Q, which may be a collection tradition. Why? Therefore, you would read in the Gospels the Gospel according to Matthew. If you look at a cursory glance of Matthew, chapter 9, verse 9, it says, "And as Jesus was walking by the way, he, Jesus, saw a tax collector called Matthew sitting by the seat of custom. And he, Jesus, came unto him, Matthew. And he, Matthew, arose and followed him, Jesus." Did God write that? No. Did Jesus write those words? No. Did Matthew write those words?
Yes.
No. If Matthew wrote that, he would have said, "And as Jesus was walking by, he saw me sitting at the receipt of custom, and he came unto me, and I arose, and I followed him." It's the third person. So the argument that you're basically saying that Matthew was written by the Apostle Matthew, the vast majority of biblical scholars, Raymond Brown, Professor Hans Kuhn, Wolfhard Pannenberg, all these are particularly biblical scholars, even William Lane Craig, who is one of the leading Christian apologists in the world, accepts and concedes Mark and priority. Mark and priority is that Mark was the first of all Gospels written, and Matthew and Luke drew their accounts from Mark's Gospel. So it was a later development. I'm not so sure what the pastor's perspective on that view is. But the conclusion among biblical scholars is that all these Gospels were written decades after Jesus left the world, and most of them were not eyewitness testimony. In fact, none of them were. The pastor's rebuttal makes mention about the forgiveness of sins, and he gives an expression in Mark chapter 2 verse 8, where he says, apparently Jesus tells the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven." But look at the story. Look at the context. When Jesus saw their faith, he saw this paralyzed man. Jesus said unto the sick, he said unto the sick of the palsy, he said to the paralyzed man, he said, "Son, thy sins are forgiven." That's what he says. And certain people around him, they were sitting there and they were having thoughts in their mind. They said, "Who can forgive sins? Only God can forgive sins." What does Jesus say? Does Jesus say, "Well, I am God, I can forgive you sins"? Does he say that? What does he say? He says, "Why do these thoughts arise in your mind? Why are you having these thoughts in your mind?" Which is better, to tell a paralyzed man, "Take up your blanket and walk," or to tell a paralyzed man, "Your sins are forgiven"? Which is better? Was he saying, "I have the right to forgive sins"? He's telling them, "Why are you having these thoughts in your mind?" In other words, they were thinking, "Only God can forgive sins." He was saying, "Why are your thoughts coming into your mind?" Look at the context. The other passage, in John chapter 10 verse 30, where the pastor says that I misquoted that particular reference. And he said, "I deliberately left out verses 32 to 33. In verses 31, after Jesus says, "I am the one," the Jews pick up stones to stone him. Jesus says to them, "Many good works I have shown you. For which of these works do you stone me?" The Jews say, "We stone you for any good works. You, being a man, are claiming to be God. That is why we are stoning you." Does Jesus then say, "I am God, I have the right to claim to be God"? He says, he rebuts them. He says, "Is it not written in your law, I said, ye are gods?" He was quoting from the 82nd chapter of the book of Psalms, which speaks about the prophets. "Ye are gods and the children of the Most High." So he rebuts the allegation. "Is it not written in your law, I said, ye are gods?" In other words, if prophets of God are called gods in the Old Testament, why are you taking exception to me when the only claim I'm making is to be the Son of God? God has got sons by the tons. In Psalms, God tells David, "I will declare a decree unto thee. The Lord has said unto me that thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee." Can God beget David at the age of 40 when David was 40 years old? No. It means something else. It's a spiritual birth. In the same way manner, in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." You look at Hebrews chapter 11, 17. Isaac is spoken as the only begotten son of Abraham. Was Isaac the only begotten son of Abraham?
No.
No. So why does Hebrews describe Isaac as the only begotten son? It must be meaning something else, not a literal begetting. Look at the context. In regards to the earlier speech made by my learned friend, he spoke about the context of the Savior, the idea of Jesus being the Savior. Now, if one were to have a general summation of the concept or the idea of the Savior, you'd find that the word is applied to people in the Old Testament other than Jesus. If you, for example, were to look at 2 Kings chapter 13 and chapter 5, for example, you'd see, for example, other individuals are described as saviors. Again, translators try to obscure the fact that God is the only savior in the same ultimate sense, and he is our only nourisher and our only protector. But over-specifying the statement that an individual is a savior alone gives a lie to the fact that in the Old Testament there were other individuals who were described as saviors, as deliverers, as judges. You look at the book of Judges. What about the idea about Jesus being the light of the world? That, I suggested, is only to be found in the Gospel of John. In none of the three Gospels is that ever mentioned. In the Quran, and indeed we would admit in the Islam, who is the light of the world? Only Allah. Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. Only Allah is the light in the heavens and the earth. Not Jesus. The idea about being saved, that again is a discussion for tomorrow, where we will discuss the issue of the crucifixion. But just on that particular point, if you look at Genesis chapter 2, verse 17, it says, God tells Adam and Eve, "For of the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt eat, for in the day that thou eatest, thou shalt surely die." But in chapter 3, verse 6, the serpent says unto the woman, "Ye shall not surely die." How long did Adam die immediately? Or did he live for hundreds of years thereafter? So even according to the Old Testament then, the devil, God forbid it, was more rightful in his predictions than what we have here about God. Further on, one of the consequences of sin according to the Old Testament was childbirth. In Genesis 3 verse 16, you read the expression, "Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In sorrow shall you conceive, and your desire shall be to your husband. He shall rule over you," as a consequence of the childbirth. Jesus paying the price as a redemptive sacrifice for that original sin meant that childbirth, or the painful consequences of childbirth, were to be done away with. But according to the idea that we have here, women, when they give birth, still experience pain. What about the soul that sinneth? It shall die. The pastor made mention of the fact that the world can be categorized into those that are living and those that are dead. If you accept Jesus, you are living, and if you haven't, then you are dead. But that's not what the Old Testament or indeed Jesus says. Jesus doesn't say that at all. He doesn't say, only if you accept me, you will be living. Is that what he says? If you look at Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 18, you read the expression, "The soul that sins, it shall die. But the Son shall not bear the iniquity of the Father, neither shall the Father bear the iniquity of the Son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. But if the wicked will turn from all the evil that he has